someone a gold medal memory today.
Whoo, shoot this thing. Hello, everybody. This is Jerry Clower from Yazoo City, Mississippi, and I tell funny stories, and right now, I'm going to try to be funny on the Ralph Emery Show. Here's Ralph.
I wish you'd be my announcer all the time. Thank you, Jerry. Nice to welcome all you folks to our show, brought your way by Gold Medal Flower, and we're going to move on now with some moving music from Billy Crash Craddock.
Me to give up the hand of the girl I love. You tell me I'm not the man she's worthy of. But who are you to tell her who to love? That's up to her, yes, and the Lord above. You better move on.
You better move on.
Well, I know you can buy her fancy clothes and diamond rings, but I believe she's happy with me without those things. Still, you beg me, oh, to set her free, but my friend, that will never be. You better move on. I can't blame you for loving her, but can't you understand, man, she's my girl, yeah. And I, Lord, I'm never gonna let her go, 'cause I, Lord, you know that I love her so. Well, I think you'd better go now, I'm getting mighty mad. You asked me to give up the only love I ever had. Maybe I would, oh, but I love her so, I'm never gonna let her go. You better move on.
You better move on.
You better move on.
That's Billy Craddock, Billy out of Greensboro, North Carolina, with our show opener, You Better Move On. Let's listen to the Gold Medal Singers, Remember a Cold Winter Day.
Make someone a gold medal memory today. Playing in the snow on a winter afternoon, bundled up against the wind. Feeling pretty good, 'cause I know that very soon Mama's gonna call me in. 'Cause today's the day we're gonna bake a great big delicious gold medal cake. Gold medal flour makes it turn out great. Golly, I can hardly wait. Mama always lets me lick the bowl and fix the icing too. And I can hardly wait a minute more, 'cause I know what we're gonna do. Today's the day we're gonna bake a great big delicious gold medal cake. Gold medal flour makes it turn out great. Golly, I can hardly wait. Golly, I can hardly wait. Bake someone a gold medal memory today.
Our guest is Jerry Clower. And Jerry, a little while ago we touched on this, this business of making biscuits. And I mentioned that you were head of the hand-squished, choked-off biscuits society. You've been trying to get people to bake those real biscuits, haven't you?
Yes, I have, Ralph. I have formed the National Association for the Advancement of Hand-Squished Biscuit. Yeah. And you, a charter member, and some of the other heavyweight disc jockeys throughout the country is going to help me.
Now, Jerry, this is an old way of making them, right?
That's right. Get your hands over in there and squash that hog lard up and fix a biscuit that the butter will soak up in.
What's the real test of a biscuit when...
The real test of whether you got the right proportion of molasses to the right amount of cow salve butter stirred up in it. You squash it up with a fork and get it fixed right. The way you test and see if that portion is mixed properly, it'll tear a good buttermilk biscuit half in two if you drag it through it.
You know who loves that routine? And that's also a part of Jerry's album. Played this for Roy Clark, and he was very complimentary. He said, I'd forgotten all that stuff. He said, those are little things that a lot of us don't pay attention to.
Well, bless his heart. You making me feel real good. If Roy Clark likes my album, that's a great compliment.
And we're going to take this, what I call the biscuit routine, out of Jerry's album. And Jerry's got a few things to say about some of you ladies that don't make them the way he makes them.
Now, you ladies, bless your heart, can I talk to you just for a minute? All of y'all within the sound of my voice, my mama was making them biscuits and whooping them up in a big wooden bowl. She sifted that white blossom flour through a sifter and took her hand and parted that flour in the bottom of that wooden bowl and took a gob of hog lard and put over in there and squashed it up with her hand. She didn't stir it with no spoon. Squashed it up with her hand. And then poured that good clabber of buttermilk over in there and kept stirring it and working it up till she whooped up that pile of dough. Now, some folks would take a Clabber Girl baking powder can and cut them biscuit, but my mama was choking them off the end of, end of that dough there and rolling them out and take them big, pretty cat head biscuit and lay them gently in a baking pan. And then take them three fingers right there and take a little all sausage grease and daub the top of them biscuit. Now, ladies, them biscuit was fit to eat. I live on Swayze Street in Yazoo City, Mississippi. Now, this is a fine street, and there are some folks on that street, some lady folks, what try to impress their husbands and cook them biscuit before they go off to work in the morning. Now, these ladies go to the dairy case at the supermarket, and they buy these cardboard sleeves or tubes full of biscuits. And the instructions say you are to whop them on the counter and open up the little biscuits and cook them for breakfast. Every morning about 7:15, it sounds like a young war on my street. They whop, 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 whop. They opening up them biscuits. And I got news for y'all. Them biscuit ain't fit to eat.
That's Jerry Clower's advice on how to make biscuits and to avoid those in the cardboard sleeve. That comes out of a routine in Jerry's album called The Graduate Returns. Now, Mr. Hank Thompson and the Brazos Valley Boys take over the show, and here comes a song.
Well, never once have I cheated on my baby. I'm a traveling man. I go from coast to coast. Everywhere from San Diego to New York City. I never done you wrong, but I've come awful close. Well, I met a little peach when I was in Columbus, Georgia. Sitting in the booth next to mine in the little cafe. All I did was just buy her a cup of coffee. I had a heck of a time, but I pulled myself away. I've come awful close, nearly almost. I got her right next to it, but I couldn't do it. Heaven knows, I've come awful close. Well, I pulled into an all-night stop in Albuquerque. A cute little waitress brought me my ham and rye. She winked and said I'd get off at 7:30. Well, I might have stayed, but I told that gal goodbye. So, honey, don't you worry about your daddy. Just scramble my eggs and don't you burn my toast. I'm rolling now, shouldn't make it home by Friday. Lots of guys would have done it, but I just come close.
I've come awful close, nearly almost.
I got right next to it, but I couldn't do it, heaven knows. I've come awful close, yeah, I come close, honey. When I'm rolling on in home, so put on that fresh pot of coffee. Tell you what, go in and get a steak out of the freezer, and we'll open up a bottle of that good Napa Valley wine. Have ourselves a good time. Your daddy's rolling on in home.
Hank Thompson, the Brazos Valley Boys, doing I've Come Awful Close.
I remember
when Mama baked a cake. Took her as long to clean up as it did to make the cake, because she had to use so many bowls and kitchen utensils. My favorite was chocolate cake with chocolate or vanilla frosting. Mama used to let me lick the frosting bowl. Now you can make Betty Crocker Kitchen's best chocolate cake with only one bowl. You heard me right, only one bowl. Did you ever hear of anything so simple? The recipe is right in every gold medal flour sack. One mix chocolate cake. And be sure to frost your cake with Betty Crocker Whipped Frosting Mix, a frosting you simply can't make from scratch. In chocolate and vanilla, it's more like whipped cream than any other frosting. Bake a gold medal one mix chocolate cake. It's almost as easy as using a cake mix, but it tastes a whole lot better.
Take someone a gold medal memory today.
Jerry, what was it Tammy Wynette won as a teenager in high school?
Miss Tremont High.
Now, Tremont, Mississippi is in northern Mississippi.
Yeah, that's right, and if you want to get whooped up on in basketball, you go up there and play them people. They bad folks.
Isn't that right on the Alabama-Mississippi line?
That's right. Tremont, Mississippi. It's due east of Tupelo, Mississippi.
Miss Tremont High School.
That's right.
Well, it's been a long time since those days, and Tammy, of course, is singing these days with George Jones, and they make some mighty mellow music together. This is an old George Jones hit that George used to sing solo, and when Tammy and George decided on an album, they decided to do a couple of old songs that George had previously done, and the results, well, you take a listen.
Take me to your darkest room. Close every window and bolt every door. The very first moment I heard your voice, I'd be in darkness no more.
Take me to your most barren desert, 1,000 miles from the nearest sea. The very moment I saw your smile, it would be like heaven to me.
There's not any mountain too rugged to climb, no desert too barren to cross. Darling, if you would just show a sign of love, I could burn it all.
Take me to Siberia in the coldest weather of the winter time, and it would be just like spring. spring in California, as long as I knew you were mine.
Yes, it would be just like spring in California, as long as I knew you were mine. Take me.
That's the sound of George Jones and Miss Tammy Tremont, Mississippi High School Winnet, and the song called Take Me. You got to meet Johnny Paycheck a while back, didn't you?
I sure did, and he is one more fabulous entertainer.
And a real veteran of show business, too. I meant to mention something earlier, Jerry. Didn't you make your show business debut on a stage entertaining folks with Charlie Pride?
That's right. I was invited to appear on the Charlie Pride show in Jacksonville, Florida.
And from there, didn't you?
From there, I hitched a ride on Bill Anderson's bus and rode across country to do a show the next night. And that's where I got to know Bill Anderson, and then Bill invited me to Nashville to do a TV show.
You've done his television show.
Right, and then that's when things begin to happen.
Do you know Charlie's daddy?
I don't know his daddy, but I intend to go by Sledge, Mississippi, and visit with him.
I think he's a barber over there.
That's right, and he's a tremendous fella, and he... we're very proud of his famous son, and I want to go by there and congratulate him one of these days.
What did Charlie have to say to you?
Well, I don't know why I've told you this or not, Ralph, but at the country music convention back in October, somebody was behind me at the big plush dinner, and he said, Marcel Ledbetter stuck the snout of that thing through the screen door, and I looked around, it's Charlie Pride mocking old Jerry.
That's something else. I'm going to take a song from Johnny Paycheck's recent album. We were talking about Johnny a moment ago, and what a talent he is. Here's Johnny singing She's Everything to Me.
Her name is like a prayer when I'm in need. She gives me love that satisfies and always stands by me. She's the guiding light that brings me home. She smooths out the road of life that I travel on. And her sweet love is everything to me. Can't you see? She brings daylight to the darkness of my world. Without her what I'd be. Her precious love is everything to me. She's my woman, she lets me know her love won't end. She's everything I'll ever need. She's my lover, she's my friend. It takes her love to make my life complete. She's the shrine of worship. She's everything to me. Her sweet love is everything to me. Can't you see? She brings daylight to the darkness of my world. What I'd be. Her precious love is everything to me. Yes, her sweet love is everything to me. Can't you see? She brings daylight to the darkness of my world.
That's the sound of my friend who lives in Denver, Colorado these days, Johnny Paycheck. And she's everything to me. And now, my friends, it's time for Paulette.
I remember, I can remember when my little sister Jenny was just a baby. Mother would put her in the crib in the kitchen where she could keep an eye on her. and do the baking at the same time. Mother stayed so busy, it was only natural that she make some little mistakes, like in measuring. But she said that gold medal flour and a Betty Crocker recipe gave her the margin for error that she needed. Once when she took one of her wonderful cakes out of the oven, little Jenny looked up, squealed, and clapped her hands. And Mother laughed, said we'd name this cake for her. And I remember that always after that, we called it a Jenny cake. Bake someone a gold medal memory today.
Now here's a Canadian songwriter, singer, piano player, Ray Griff.
It's the morning after me.
The alarm clock woke my sleeping, but I lay there for a minute with a million cobwebs clinging to my brain. I stopped that bell from ringing in the time it takes a heartbeat, then I settled back and closed my eyes again. I reached out for my baby for some early morning loving, then the terrible truth came staggering through my head. There was nothing but the fragrance of her perfume on the pillow. Baby wasn't there beside me in the bed. It's the morning. Daybreak and a heartbreak. Only silence to torment me, no soft hand to touch me gently. It's the morning after, baby, let me down. There was nothing to hold on to but the sheets that fell around me, and I started in trembling like a leaf. How could that woman leave me? She was more than just a lover. She was every bit a lady, warm and sweet. I can taste the salty teardrops. God, it's getting hard to swallow. Hope a glass of bourbon takes the lump away. Got no appetite for eating, just a sick and empty feeling. What a good for nothing way to start the day. It's the morning after, baby, let me down. It's the daybreak and the heartbreak that I found. Only silence to torment me, no soft hand to touch me gently. It's the morning after, baby, let me down. It's the morning after, baby, let me down. It's the daybreak and the heartbreak.
It's Ray Griff singing "The Morning After, Baby, Let Me Down."
My, here I am on the Ralph Emery Show. That's what you're listening to. And I'm Jerry Clower, and I'll never be the same after spending a whole week with Ralph Emery.
Hey, Jerry, this young fella I know you've worked with, so you might just put him on.
Man, old Brian Collins. He's a tremendous fella. I've learned to love him. He is a good entertainer, and he's gonna sing "There's a Kind of Hush."
There's a kind of hush all over the world tonight. All over the world, you can hear the sounds of lovers in love. Just the two of us and nobody else. in sight. There's nobody else, and I'm feeling good, just holding you tight. So hold me very tenderly, closer now, and you will see what I mean. It isn't a dream. The only sound that you will hear is when I whisper in your ear, I love you. Forever and ever. There's a kind of hush all over the world tonight. All over the world you can hear the sounds of lovers in love. There's a kind of hush all over the world tonight. All over the world, people just like us are falling in love.
All over the world,
people just like us are falling in love.
All over the world,
you can hear the sounds of lovers in love.
That's Brian Collins. Brian on the show. Brian, the Texas City boy, who's looking forward to a day pretty soon for him. Texas City's going to honor him. Texas City, Texas, going to have a whole day for him. And he's only been in show business, making records for about 8-9 months. Brian doing There's a Kind of Hush. Hey, Jerry, I want to get back to Charlie Pride for a moment. You told me a moment ago that Charlie Pride wrote you a letter.
Yes, he promised me some pictures. Said he'd send them to me. And he sent me 2 pictures of him in living color to my home buddy, Charlie Pride. And wrote me a nice letter, and I appreciate it very much.
You had to get on him to send you those pictures.
Yes, I did. I told him I was going to have to get on him pretty good. He got to be such a big heavyweight, he kind of was fixing to sell his birthright there and forget us Mississippi folks.
Jerry, it's the practice on this show. When a fellow's got a hot routine or a hot record, we play it more than once. So here on this show, as we near the close, I thought we'd have you do the coon hunting story once more. I imagine an awful lot of folks wonder if you're really putting them on, if you ever really experienced any of this stuff.
That's true. I get calls occasionally, and people write me letters and want to know if I ever coon hunted, but a real coon hunter doesn't ask that question because he knows I have been there, because I just know too much about it.
Let's go coon hunting.
John Eubanks was a great American. He was a professional tree climber. He didn't believe. I'm telling you the truth. He didn't believe in shooting no coon out of no tree. It was against his upbringing. He taught us from birth, from the day we were born till the age we could keep listening to him. Give everything a sporting chance. Whatever you do, give it a sporting chance. He'd have been a great conservationist today if he'd be here. And John said, take a crosscut saw coon hunting week. When you tree a coon, hold the dogs and cut the tree down. Or either climb the tree and make the coon jump in amongst the dogs. Give him a sporting chance. A lot of times we climb a tree and make a coon jump in amongst 20 dogs, but at least he had the option of whooping all them dogs and walking off if he wanted to. This is strictly left up to the coon. So I said, Mr. Barron, we'd be glad to go hunting with you. You know, he was a rich man. He had sold a lot of cotton during the First World War for $1 a pound. He had some world-renowned dogs. And we hollered three or four times and they started hunting. We listened and directly, old Brummy didn't bark at nothing but a coon. He had a deep voice, but when he cut down on him, it was a coon. Don't worry about no possum or no bobcat. Brummy was running a coon. And then old Trailer and old Highball and them famous dogs and Mr. Barron's got in there with them and old John Newbanks and holler, hey, speak to him. And my brother Sonny holler, hey, look for. And oh, it was beautiful. Now y'all get this picture. About that time they treed, we rushed down into the swamps. And there the dogs were, treed up the biggest sweet gum tree in all of Amit River swamps. It was huge. You couldn't reach around this tree. There wasn't a limb on it for a while. Way up there, huge tree. And I looked around at John and I said, John, I don't believe you can climb that tree. And it hurt John's feelings. He pooched his lips out, got fighting mad. He said, there ain't a tree in all these swamps that I can't climb. And he got his Brogan shoes off and he eased up to that sweet gum tree and he hung his toenails in that bark and he got his fingernails in there and he kept easing up the tree, working his way toward that bottom limb, and he finally got to it and he started on up into this big tree. Knock him out, John. It won't be long. And John worked his way on up to the top of the tree and whoo, what a big one. And he reached around in his overhauls and got that sharp stick and he drawed back and he punched the coon. But it wasn't a coon. It was a lynx. We call them souped-up wildcats in Amit County. And that thing had great big tushies coming out of its mouth and red big claws on the end of its feet. And people, that thing attacked it, John, up in the top of that tree. Whoa! You can hear John squall. What's the matter with John? I don't have no idea. What in the world's happening to John? Knock him out, John. Whoa! This thing's killing me. The whole top of the tree was shaking. The dogs got to biting the bark of the tree and fighting one another underneath the tree. And I was kicking them like, you dogs, get away. What's the matter with John? Knock him out, John. Whoa! This thing's killing me. And John knew that Mr. Barron told it a pistol in his belt to shoot snakes with. And he kept hollering, whoa, shoot this thing. Have mercy, this thing killing me. Shoot this thing. And Mr. Barron said, John, I can't shoot up in there. I might hit you. John said, well, just shoot up in here amongst us. One of us got to have some relief.
Jerry Clower, our guest star this week, doing, you ought to title that Knock Him Out, John. That's called The Coon Hunt.
Ralph, at this point, I think it'd be a good idea if you told me why they call Gold Medal Flour by that name.
Well, Jerry, that name was won over 90 years ago at the Miller's International Exhibition in Cincinnati. On June the 8th, 1880, the flour you now know as Gold Medal won the gold medal for being the best flour at the exhibition. After this award, Gold Medal became the brand name for General Mills' finest flour. Since then, Gold Medal flour has helped four generations of mothers bake delicious memories for their families. And today, the same painstaking care is given to the milling of Gold Medal flour as was back in 1880. So, with Gold Medal flour and a Betty Crocker recipe, you can be sure your baking will come out right, even if you make little measuring mistakes. That's why they say Gold Medal gives you a margin for error. Why don't you bake a Gold Medal memory for someone you love today?
Bake someone a Gold Medal memory today.
Next up on the show, the sound of Merle Haggard. Let's reach back for one.
You always find a way to hurt my pride. If I'm not crying, you're not satisfied. I don't know why you want to hurt me so. But if you're trying to break my heart, You don't have very far to go. You don't have very far to go before the heartache begins. I already feel the sadness of a heartbreak setting in. You can't love me and still love to hurt me so. If you're trying to break my heart, you don't have very far to go. I already feel the sadness of a heartbreak setting in. You're turning down the flame of love too low. If you're trying to break my heart, you don't have very far to go.
An oldie but Merle Haggard, You Don't Have Very Far to Go. Boy, you know I can't get Bobby G. Rice to talk to me. I've had him on a few shows, not this one, but he will not talk. And he wrote me a letter the other day, he really did, and it was four lines. I got a great big envelope, Bobby G. Rice, return address, and I thought, well, at least he writes if he doesn't talk. And it was four lines. Thank you for playing my record. Let's hope you're doing well. Have a happy new year, and see you around. That was it. Talks as much as he writes, but he does sing a lot. Here's Bobby G. Rice.
Still not certain that you love me. Every time you hold me, I'm still not certain that you care. Though you keep on saying you really, really, really love me. Do you say the same words to someone else when I'm not there?
Suspicion
torments my heart.
Suspicion
keeps us apart.
Suspicion,
why can't you leave? Every time you call me and tell me we should meet tomorrow, I can't help but think that you're meeting someone else tonight. Why should our romance just keep on causing me this sorrow? Why am I so doubtful whenever you were out of sight?
Suspicion
torments my heart.
Suspicion
keeps us apart.
Suspicion,
why talk to me? Darling, if you love me, I beg you wait a little longer. Wait until I drive all these foolish tears out of my eyes. Why can't our romance just keep on growing even stronger? Maybe I'm suspicious, cause true love is so hard to find.
Suspicion
torments my heart.
Suspicion
keeps us apart.
Suspicion,
why talk to me?
Suspicion.
That's Bobby G. Rice singing Suspicion. Hey, Mr. Disc Jockey, how about taking over at this point?
Yes, sir. Man, I'd be glad to, and I want everybody to listen to that Sammy Smith sing. My, she's gonna sing Kentucky.
Won't forget the first time that I saw him. I overheard somebody say Kentucky was his name. He just stood there unconcerned, and sang as though the angels were all listening. And I was passing through on my way to some forlorn, forgotten place. I only planned a while away, a lost and lonely Texas winter evening. But I found myself a-wishing I could stay and listen to Kentucky sing. Won't you sing that song again, Kentucky?
Kentucky,
down the smile and sing along with you. And I'll be on my way again, Kentucky. That Texas winter night so long ago. The dreams that I was dreaming then have finally become reality. Now we just go from town to town, laughing, singing every song we know. Life is good for me and my Kentucky. So let's sing that song again, Kentucky. Song, I'll gently reach and touch you.
Sweet singing Sam. Super Sam. Sammy Smith singing about the guitar player known as Kentucky. Now it's memory time with the gold medal singers.
Make someone a gold medal memory today.
Mama would call from the kitchen door, come on, it's time to bake some more. I'd be there on the run, 'cause I knew we'd have lots of fun.
Baking up a gingerbread man, baking up a gingerbread man. Get the gold medal flour and the baking pan, baking a gingerbread man.
Now my daughter's 6 years old, and she doesn't have to be told. When it's gold medal baking day, I can always hear her say,
we're baking up a gingerbread man, baking up a gingerbread man. Get the gold medal flour and the baking pan, baking a gingerbread man, baking a gingerbread man. Make someone a gold medal memory today.
Now, appropriately, our last song is called Leaving and Saying Goodbye, and here's Jack Green.
So many times I told you I was leaving, and so many times how I tried. Saying you're leaving so much easier than leaving and saying goodbye. 'Cause every time I'd start to go, I wouldn't get 10 feet till I'd come running back like a runaway child who's afraid to cross the street. My My mind might tell my lips to say it's over, but my heart would only know it's a lie. 'Cause saying you're leaving so much easier than leaving and saying goodbye. Every time I'd start to go, I wouldn't get 10 feet till I'd come running back like a runaway child who's afraid to cross the street. My mind might tell my lips to say it's over, but my heart would only know it's a lie. Saying you're leaving so much easier than leaving and saying goodbye, than leaving and saying goodbye.
That's our final song. That's by Jack Green, Jack with Leaving and Saying Goodbye. Hey, Jerry, I want to thank you very much for being here on the Ralph Emery Show for Gold Medal Flower. I really had a ball.
Man, me too. It's been a great week, and I've listened to your very fine show before, and little did I know that one day I'd be honored to be on it for a whole week. And I want to thank you, Ralph. I hope you invite me back sometime.
I sure will.
It's been a wonderful time.
Thank you, Jerry. Jerry Clower, our guest this week. Next week, we take on Nat Stuckey and all his records. We hope you'll be listening. Bye-bye.